All right. Hello and welcome to another Expert Insight interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPop, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And today I am delighted to welcome back Tishane Johnson, who is motivational speaker, Marine Corps veteran, and he does the hike across America. And this is what we want to talk about today. So he hikes across America and does motivational and inspiring speaking along the way. So first of all, Shane, tell us a little bit about why you started this and what the origin of the hike is.
Well, so it kind of came to fruition about 4 years ago. The idea behind the project was, I was running a mortgage company in Central Florida, and I had a conversation with a real estate agent, and she was telling me a little bit about the situation about a gentleman that ended up having his left leg amputated due to the fact he couldn't get transportation to and from the VA hospital. Mm-hmm. And where it was at, it took anywhere from 2 to 3 hours just to drive from the bus stop to the VA. So these gals and guys didn't have proper transportation, so they had to walk anywhere between 8 and 15 miles a day, sleep on park benches, just to get to the bus that took another 2 hours. So it was just an interesting conversation with her because, the veteran, once he had lost his leg, the post there had helped him get a wheelchair. And, they said, well, what's the first thing you're gonna do when you get your prosthetic leg? And he says, well, I just want to hurry up and get it so someone else can have this wheelchair. So it kind of led to the fact of that, even still now, he's willing to sacrifice kind of just that luxury so that someone else can kind of, hopefully use it, to better themselves. So I just felt like a need to do something. That was kind of before hiking across America was really a commodity. It seems mm-hmm. like everybody seems to be doing it in some capacity or another now. And so I said, well, why don't we start with a little hike? Let's raise some awareness. Let's get out there and market it just like you would any business. Let's connect with people on a local level. Let's not do it through social media because, just social media mirrors only the things that you like and discuss. And let's find out what the real issues are.
Yeah.
So we got out there and connected. It was a huge success. We raised some money. We helped a couple of veterans. We did some stuff. But more importantly, I think more than raising awareness, I learned a lot more about the veteran community and what some issues were along the way. So once I kind of got a hold of that, we were about, 3/4 of the way through it. And I realized, I wonder what it'd be like to go across the country. Let's kind of see what everybody's like in different states and cities. And so the following year we went into that, I ran across the country. We got some big sponsors. I did 3,000 miles, about 22 miles every single day. I carried a 30-pound pack, talked in 20 cities, 9 states, slept in homeless shelters. And I really wanted to get a perspective on why the veteran community was, there were so many homeless, so many suicides. Mm-hmm. And first I had to, talk with them, kind of find out why they're there, and what's going on. So we go into year 3. After that was a big success. Helped over 10,000 veterans. I think we raised about 150,000 in total in 65 days. Had a lot of really good conversations, a lot of speaking. And then the third year I did it for teen homelessness. I carried 100 pounds for 1,600 miles for about 65 days to focus on teen homelessness because I noticed that across the country that, it's not like homeless people stop having kids. So, sure. They still had families and children and lives and all these same things like we do every day. And noticed that there was a big void for that. And then after 3 years of doing it and growing across the country and connecting with so many different people, I came to the realization that, believe it or not, that the true homeless, the ones that are struggling the most were the middle class. And the byproduct of people focusing so much on their business and focusing so much on what we think in America is such an important thing, which is monetary gain or hours worked or all of those things, the byproduct of that was producing a society of young people who had no guidance, no leadership, no family values, and then they become independent and found it in drugs or problems or issues, and they end up being the ones homeless. So I thought mm-hmm. it would be a good idea to get back to the source. So this year, we came up with more of a speaking tour that incorporated the hike because people like to pay attention to the hike yeah. portion. But and then we went on a leadership and family values tour. We had scheduled 36 different venues, over 180,000 people in attendance in total. We put a couple of world records in there to kind of spice it up, get people to pay attention. So I just set the first world record about two Saturdays ago, and that's kind of how this all came to fruition.
No, that's a fantastic story. So what do you think would, so today we are obviously, like you said, I mean, we're in social media, whatever, we're bombarded with all these, you know, messages and all of that kind of stuff. But what did you learn from going across the country and meeting different people in different places? Because it seems to me like that's something that anybody who runs for political office should probably join you on your next one and go across the country and get a broader perspective on what people are really like. But what are some of the things that maybe surprised you or inspired you?
I think it's the two things I talk about this year. It's the ridiculously extreme lack of leadership and acceptance of responsibility. You know, the older generation says there's something wrong with these kids today, not realizing they're the ones that raised them. You know, they don't accept the responsibility to say, hey, maybe I slacked a little bit as a parent, or I didn't focus on this because maybe I wanted more for them and I didn't want them to go through the tough things I went through or the things that happened, but spare the rod, spoil the child. You know, what ended up happening is, again, the byproduct of that was, you know, lack of leadership. I talked to a lot of the military community. It's interesting because you talk to, you know, my generation, which is not an old generation, but it is definitely an instant willingness and obedience to all orders platform, and, you know, trust in your leader. So execute accordingly. Whereas now, you know, everybody wants to question all of your leaders because they don't trust them. And I think that's really, you know, my big thing was, and then family values. I mean, you know, if we peeled this back and went into my day job of executive leadership coaching and working with C-suite company, you know, executives and companies, you know, they've got so many structures, so many coaches, so many plans on how to run an effective business, how to nurture an employee that they kind of barely know, but not one person really focuses on how to do that with your family. And so what ends up happening is they focus so much on this business, they focus so much on growing people and nurturing relationships with clients that they barely know, and create all these platforms and CRMs that they don't even know how to pick up the phone and talk to their own kid or their spouse correctly. And that ends up being a byproduct of what I've seen out on the streets. It's just, you know, dad wasn't around, mom's not there, someone didn't pay attention to me. And then leaders, you know, are scared to make decisions. They're not true leaders. You know, sometimes you just got to make that decision that sucks, but that's the point of being a leader. It's not sexy or glamorous.
Well, no, it's not. And unfortunately, we live in as I said, I mean, there's a pervasive popular culture out there where it's sort of everything needs to be happy and cool all the time, right? So it's like, as you say, even you see the pervasive, like, leadership mantras that a lot of people put out. It's all about make people happy all the time, make people happy all the time, which as you say, if you're going to provide proper leadership, it's not always about making people happy all the time. It's about doing the right thing and making the right decisions. And sometimes those are hard decisions.
Well, I mean, I guess maybe a good way to look at it is, you know, I have a 5-year-old daughter, and, you know, I'm sure every day she'd love to eat chocolate cake, right? I mean, if we got up this morning and I gave her chocolate cake, she'd be so happy. And daddy, you're the best daddy in the world. And daddy, I love you. Let me eat chocolate cake. And, you know, 5-10 years later, my daughter's, you know, 300 pounds. She's got, you know, diabetes. She's got issues. She's sick all the time. She's going to go, daddy, why did you let me eat chocolate cake all the time?
Right.
You know, I mean, it goes back to the same thing is that we just have to make decisions sometimes that aren't always appealing to everyone. But is a saying I say in all my speeches, we purchase pleasure for our inability to endure pain. So we don't understand that pain is built by design. It's something that's there for us. You know, your muscle doesn't grow unless you tear it down and you work it. You know, you're not going to lose the weight unless you actually eat the right food and make some sacrifices. It's built by design. It's supposed to be that way. We just, you know, corporate America, I think, has done a really good job on marketing to us to say, hey, you don't really want to work hard? That's cool. Buy my product. It's really easy. And it's just been pushed in our head for so long that we now just believe that everything should be easy. You know, and that's just not how we're developed, how it's built.
Yeah, no, I always love those ones where, you know, if you're, you know, sitting on the couch, or especially in the old days when you sit on the couch and the infomercial would come on at 3 a.m. in the morning, you got a big bag of chips in your hand and the guy's telling you, you know, you only have to exercise, you know, for 1 minute every 6 months and you will like have a ripped body, and you're like, ooh, that sounds good.
All right. Yeah.
Yeah. And so one of the other things I think, you know, an interesting one maybe, and you've come across, is I think you're correct, especially now. I think people focus far too much a lot of the time, like on social media and other, on these big issues and macro things and ranting and raving or whatever, when at the end of the day, if everybody focused on, you know, being the best person, parent, partner, person in the community, we would build much better up from, you know, stronger communities, as opposed to like sitting on your couch with a beer, ranting about some global issues that you've got no control over.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this tour has been interesting because I've spoken to homeless shelters. I've spoken to, you know, 50,000 people in a stadium during a football game. You know, I've spoken to the Navy, the Army, the Marine Corps. Mm-hmm. I've had conversations with all of them, and, you know, I always kind of say the same thing to them. It's never going to be policy, politicians, government that's ever going to change anything. You know, the reason why our country is the way that it is because we used to at one point sit down at a dinner table and talk to each other. You know, mm-hmm. there's a funny little saying I say, if we all washed our own dishes, there wouldn't be any dishes to wash. You know, so, I mean, if we took the time to police our own and keep within our doors of our house what happens in our house and raise based on good morals and characters and values, and they understand that, you know, we wouldn't have as many issues and problems. But everybody wants to jump in someone else's house and they want to say how it should be done and what it should be done. And they forget that social media is a business. You know, it is an advertising platform. It is not this just pure, you know, forum that you can just discuss without some type of ulterior motive. I mean, it is built by design. The algorithms are specifically focused and tailored based on what you like. And it's to produce content on that so that you stay engaged. I mean, it's just a completely different level of media. And now they've gotten so smart that they engage each person in the home. Whereas it used to be a family would sit behind one TV, but now it's matter of fact, children are made fun of to not have that device on them at all times. And they're poor. And they're not up to level with the Joneses if they don't have it. So the children come home and say, "Daddy, I got to have that iPhone, or I got to have that tablet, or I've got to have access to it." You know, so the companies have just done a phenomenal job of doing that. So now, you know, your daughter is in a room at 5 playing on YouTube, and someone else is telling her how to have her manners or how to respect her parents or what to do. And you, as a parent, you're lazy. You're not owning up to that responsibility of taking the time with them, and it just runs amok. And we forget, you know, we think that it's just this Switzerland-based, you know, a platform where we can just say whatever we want and they're there for our own best interests. And it's not, it's there to grow a business.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. And obviously, you know, the news today, if, you know, some people still don't realize, I mean, the news is not there to inform you. It's there to provoke a reaction from you. And, you know, you obviously people get their news from wherever they sit on the spectrum. And it's designed to provoke and keep you in a constant state of angst and anger, which isn't healthy for anyone. So as you go across the country and you talk to people, how are you finding the differences? Are there big differences as you move through different parts of the country, or are at the essence, are you finding that people are all pretty similar?
You know, that's a really good question, John. When I started this hike and then it started to evolve into more of a conversation of mm-hmm. leadership and family values, I really thought that I was going to get tarred and feathered. I thought people were, I really did. I didn't think people were going to agree with my type of mindset of enough's enough and you guys need to accept responsibility and you know, kind of slap around drill instructor type thing. But it has been arms wide open across the board. I mean, every once in a while, I'll have someone in the veteran community that'll kind of challenge it a little bit because they're really sold on the fact that we're owed or we're entitled to something as a veteran, which I completely disagree with. It has been eye-opening to hear parents or leaders or people come along and say, wow, like, you're so right. We really need, they're starving for it. It's the craziest thing. I've never seen anything like it before. It's not, you go into one city and one city believes it. It's not Republican or Democrat. It's not different backgrounds or demographics. I mean, I went into a homeless shelter and they equally received the message just as well as I did walking into, you know, the Corps cadets of mm-hmm. young, you know, military. I mean, it's like, it's a very open response. So I don't really see, I just think they're actually starving for it. They're like, man, great. Somebody that's not saying it, but also doing it. And we want to do that too. You know, it was a really weird experience actually.
Yeah. And it's funny. And I think getting back again is I think your message is timely because unfortunately, I think, as I said, in the pervasive culture is that everything should be easy. And if it's hard, then, you know, find it. There's obviously something else you can do that's much easier, right? It's always about easy, quick, And so, I mean, I think your message is very timely. So how do you reach out then to people who maybe, you know, sort of say, you know, I just don't know where to start. Like, I've tried, but, you know, nothing ever seems to work. So I'm kind of giving up.
Yeah. So that's broken up into layers, because there's, you know, you have some people on the veteran side that they, you know, they're contemplating suicide. You've got mm-hmm. teens. I mean, 935 teens attempt suicide a day. You know, it's like a hot topic. It's like a fad now to commit suicide. It's like there's so many issues and things addressed out there that people feel that they've got to run away from it. And I blame dads. I mean, I'm not a mom. So I start mm-hmm. with the dads, and I see that the responsibility of the fathers, you know, they're so focused on, I gave a seminar yesterday. It's a Done by 2:30. It's about my third book coming out with my daughter and I. Yeah. And I was having a conversation with some real estate agents, and I was telling them about, you know, how they need to focus on their business and be done by 2:30 every day. And they're like, there's no way we could get that done. That doesn't make any sense. And how am I supposed to do this? And blah, blah, blah. And I said, okay, so let's just say today you find out that your daughter has cancer, and mm-hmm. she's only got a couple of months left to live. And the only way that you can effectively run your business and spend time with her before she goes is that you have to accomplish this goal by 2:30. And that's how you have to run your business. Would you be able to do it? Right. And I would say 99.9% of the people shake their head in the room. So I said, okay, mm-hmm. so it's not that you can't do it, it's that you choose to not to, or that the level of commitment is not high enough, like something like that. Now I go back to, okay, so let's say, for instance, that same passion for your daughter is the same way. Well, don't you want to spend time with her no matter what? Because cancer is something that can happen anytime. You know, mm-hmm. not to say that you got to live your life fear-based, but you definitely got to put yourself in a position of going, man, if I could buy back that time, I'd be all over it. You know, so I think it's important for people to understand that, you know, like being as a father, we've got to commit ourselves to our family and our children a heck of a lot more than we do our businesses. I mean, you know, not for nothing, but I mean, we develop objections, sales platforms, CRMs, mm-hmm. email sequences, sales funnels, all of these things to generate a return on investment from a complete stranger. But when I ask people to raise their hand and say, how many of you sent a thank you card to your husband, your wife, or your kid each week? How many of you have sent a text message that constantly lets them know how proud of you are, that set up on a sequence? Raise your hand. And of course, you know, maybe 30% of the room may do that. And it's mm-hmm. like, this is the reason why we're having so many problems in our country today. It's because leaders aren't willing to do the hard work. We're also telling people to do something, you know, that we're not willing to do ourselves. And at the same time, we have serious problems with going back to our family and committing to taking time to invest in them, so that way we can make sure that our future is good to go. You know, I went on a huge rant about this earlier last week, where I talked about the fact that, you know, in our country, the way that we are, that we're so focused on everyone else but our family. And it just doesn't make any sense to me, because, you know, today's society wants to know what's in it for them all across the board. Mm-hmm. When I remember a society, you know, that used to say, let's plant the acorns in the ground so that someone can enjoy the shade later. You know, no one talks about the children. They always say, well, you know, I want to keep this person in office because they're, you know, I'm getting jobs now. Well, I'm not really concerned about that. I'm concerned about, does my child look up to a leader and think to themselves, I want to be that? So it inspires them to continue that tradition of making sure that our country is in the right place throughout that time. And I just don't feel like across the board leaders are like that anymore. I want my daughter to say, wow, you know, this is who I want to be when I grow up. I want to sing, or I want to be an actress, or I want to, you know, do these things. I want her to be a productive citizen of the community and make an impact. So rather than complain and say, why isn't someone else like that? I have mm-hmm. to work on being the epitome of that as a father and represent that leadership. So if it takes me carrying 100 pounds and running across the country and talking to people and sleeping in shelters and doing whatever we're going to do, my daughter looks at her father and says, you know what, Dad, I want to be you. And I think, mm-hmm. well, you be your own person, but at least I'm being a good enough leader that represents something that you feel is important. So, you know, we've all got a responsibility we've got to follow about that.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. And like I said, I think that's where you've got to start, is you've got to start in your own, you know, your own life with the people around you. And if everybody did that, the world would be a much better place. As I said, rather than focusing externally on things that probably you have very little impact, effect, or control over. And one other interesting thing that you mentioned, we actually as a company made this decision a while back, is that a lot of companies in our position would when they get to a certain point, would start to build offices, right, and force people to come to the office and probably put it somewhere like Silicon Valley and have it, you know, and then you're suddenly you're forcing people to commute into the office, live in high cost areas. You're putting all this stress on people, where in a business like ours, we were like, no, why don't we just let people live where they want, you know, work from home, have more family time, not be commuting, not be whatever, and build a better type of organization where people can have the time to invest in their family rather than spending 2 hours or 3 hours commuting every day and have the stress of living in high cost areas. So I think I totally agree with your message. And I think that there is a responsibility on organizations to actually create the environment for or people in those organizations, to force the organizations to create the environments where they can invest as much time in family and things and create that real balance.
Well, yeah, I mean, look, anytime when I'm building and developing, let's say I go into a company and the company mm-hmm. says, okay, Shane, we're going to hire you to come in and evaluate our situation. The first thing I always do is when's the last time you've had a dinner with a spouse? You know, if you're a manager and you run a team and you're doing sales or you're working a lot of hours, when's the last time you've engaged with their children, their spouse? Because that's mm-hmm. the buy-in. That's the boss. That's the decision maker. You know, those are the ones that you've got to be able to have committed to your cause and your reason to make sure that, you know, that you're going to work late, because they want to know, you know, why am I doing this? What's our reason? What's our cause behind it? And that company has to infiltrate themselves in within that organization and make sure that they're committed to the family first and foremost, because, you know, if they're not, it's just going to cause problems later, you know. And if you're doing it from home, it's amazing, but they also have got to remember, you know, being from home just means that you save time from commute. You know, they've got to make sure that they also structure the day accordingly to, you know, engage. Because I know the downside sometimes to working from home is that computer is right there. So when people wake up, you know, they go right to that computer, they go right to the emails, they go right to the stuff versus being able to kind of cut it off a little bit. But, you know, you've got to start there as a corporation. I mean, you know, people, especially in America, we work more at our jobs than we spend time with our families. And I think it's mm-hmm. important to get the families engaged and get the buy-in, you know, of a great organization. I mean, turnover is costly, you know, so it's better just to make sure that you dedicate time and invest in these employees and family right off the bat.
Yes, fantastic. All right. Well, listen, Shane, this has been, you know, fantastic as usual. I'm delighted you could come back and talk to us. I'm sure you've got a busy day ahead of yourself. Are you walking today?
I already did this morning. So 12 to 22 miles every day with 100 pounds first thing in the morning to get the day started, and then off to the work world. So we've got about 7 weeks to the next world record. And then of course a lot of speaking engagements along the way, and then all the fun stuff I do throughout the day. So yes, sir. Yeah. Getting ready to rock and roll.
And how can people get involved or find out more or figure out where you are?
Sure. They can go to hikeacrossamerica.com or tshaneinspires.com.
Hi, Chris. And all of those links will be available when this is, you know, in the bio, et cetera, that goes along with this. Well, listen, Shane, this has been fantastic. It's, again, you know, totally inspired by what you do. It's amazing. And when is your new book out yet, Done by 2:30?
No, sir. It'll be out in January. It's out for pre-sale now. If they go to the website or if they go on Amazon, it's there. They can get their copy now, and I'll personally sign it once they go out in January.
Absolutely. Perfect. All right. Well, listen, again, best of luck with the rest of your hiking and all the inspirational work you do. And thanks for joining me here. John Golden, Sales Pop Online, Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. See you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.